Welcome to Rotary Matters on 92.7 Arrow FM and also broadcasting on Wairarapa TV. I'm Marilyn Buzaid, and over the next hour, I'll be bringing you some of the activities of our Rotary clubs throughout the Wairarapa. I belong to the Rotary Club of Masterton South, which is one of five in the Wairarapa, and we belong to District 9940, which extends all the way up as far as New Plymouth. I was very privileged to be able to welcome today a most distinguished guest on our program, because we have here today to talk to you our District Governor, Gillian Jones. And also, I'm hoping to welcome later on in the program Freya Kerr from Masterton South, who's going to be talking about the rider driving program. So welcome to you in particular, Gillian, and it's great to have you here. So
thank you, Marilyn. It's really lovely to be here to have this opportunity.
So this is probably the first time that you've been put on the spot and have to talk about Rotary Matters.
It is indeed. It is. I have to say, over the last 9 months that I've been District Governor, I've found myself suddenly having to talk on quite a few occasions. So I'm starting to get used to it. But this is a lovely opportunity, though, to be on TV and to be able to reach a wider audience than we often do.
Yes.
Normally, my conversations or opportunities to speak are in front of Rotarians. But
this is good when it's going out.
Great to have this wider. Yeah.
Yeah. So tell me, perhaps you tell me a little bit about yourself. I mean, you do live in the Wairarapa, but you don't belong to a Wairarapa club. So
that's right. Yes. So yes, I live in the Wairarapa. I live in Greytown. My husband Kevin and I moved back to Greytown about 10 years ago. Prior to that, we'd been living in Wellington, and so I belong to the Rotary Club of Wellington, and the reason for that is we were living there for quite some time, but my work's in Wellington largely, so it made sense, and it was much easier to attend a Rotary Club in Wellington than to hop on a train and hope that we got to a Rotary meeting on time in the Wairarapa. So, yeah, so that's the reason for it. But I'm actually a Wairarapa girl.
Yes, and now I heard that.
Yeah.
So tell us a bit about your past life in the Wairarapa.
In the Wairarapa. So, yes, I was born and bred in Dalefield, actually, out of Carterdon.
Mm-hmm.
And on a dairy farm. My parents had a small dairy farm. And so I went to school here. And then when I left school and went to university, I went to Wellington, and then stayed away. Well, obviously I visited, but in terms of living, I then lived in Wellington for a while, and then we travelled. My husband and I travelled to various places. We were lucky enough to get to Sydney and to London, and then came back to New Zealand and moved around New Zealand quite a bit, but then went back to Wellington. And so yes, the Wairarapa and the Wellington area feel like my home base.
Home. Yeah. So how did you get yourself into Rotary?
So I was asked by a girlfriend if I would like to come along to a Rotary meeting. And I have to say, I didn't know very much at all about Rotary at that stage. It was about 20 years ago. So I went to a Rotary meeting, and the reason that I was interested at that stage was that I'd recently started my own business, and I actually saw it as a networking opportunity.
Yes, it's true. Yeah.
So that's interesting. And now that I know more about Rotary, much more about Rotary, I find that Paul Harris, who started Rotary in 1905, actually set up this very small group of his mates, who were all professional people, for networking purposes. So you know, it's a valid reason for joining Rotary.
It is interesting, isn't it, too? Also, because I joined after I'd retired from teaching, and I found that I sort of felt as though I needed a large group of people, having been on a large staff, and I found that Rotary sort of filled that gap.
Yeah, that's great. In fact, my background's quite similar to yours then, Marilyn, because I had, as I say, just set up a business for myself, but I had just left teaching. And so I'd been in the school environment for many, many years, and when the opportunity came for me to, you know, to join a professional body that took me into the adult world rather than,
into
you know,
children.
Kids, rather than children, then, you know, it was a great opportunity to sort of start to, you know, put myself out there a wee bit.
And so you were a president of the Wellington Club?
Yes, I was a president of the Rotary Club of Harbour City, which is the one that I joined initially. And I was an assistant governor during that time as well for a couple of years. So I was assistant governor of one of the areas within Wellington. And then Harbour City closed, and so I needed another club to join, and I decided that the Rotary Club of Wellington, which meets at lunchtime, was at that stage
was
I was living in the Wairarapa, so a lunchtime meeting
was
actually
good.
Worked very well.
So assistant governor, tell me, is that something that you then go on to be a governor from? Or not necessarily?
Not necessarily, no. So assistant governors are, in our district is one of the largest districts in New Zealand.
Yes, because it goes, I was trying to remember whether it goes over the Cook Strait, it does, doesn't it?
No,
it's just Wellington.
It's Wellington. So as you said in the intro, it's it goes up to Taranaki.
Yes.
It goes to Oakuni, Taihape, Whanganui.
That's a lot.
So it's quite a large area, and then down Manawatu and Hutt and Wellington. So in our district, we've got at the moment 13 assistant governors. It is a big area, you know, and part of the governor role is that we try to visit every club during our year's tenure. And so that's fine, you know, we can do that, but then we might only see some of those outlying clubs only once during that year. And so the assistant governor is a really important person, because each assistant governor has about three or four or five clubs that they have responsibility for. So that works well. And So I will communicate a lot with my assistant governors, and they in turn will communicate with their clubs.
Yes.
And so that's, you know, it's a very, it's a...
It's a good...
It works well.
Because it's like a cluster, isn't it? Because Rob Cameron is our assistant governor at the moment.
Exactly. Yes,
Rob's been... And he's got that cluster.
He's been a great assistant governor for the last 3 years, actually. And we are not calling it a cluster at the moment.
Oh no, of course, that's right. No, he did say that to me. Yes, no, we're no longer a cluster. He didn't come up with what the new word was.
Right. I decided that no one wanted to be part of a cluster at the moment.
No, we've got enough clusters. Yes,
so we're calling it a network. And that's actually
good.
A good word, because
it is,
you know, I'm very keen that clubs work together. You know, I think in the past, clubs have sometimes worked in quite an isolated way. Mm. This club has their programs and does it their way, and then another club, which might be quite close by, might have a different focus.
Mm.
And I think that's a real shame, because, you know, if we can collaborate, then there's a much greater opportunity to, you know, to do wider good, really.
Right.
And so, to support each other.
So that's really with this radio program too. It's sort of a collaboration of the
good.
Well, at the moment it's three clubs, which is good.
It does make a difference, I think, because we draw on the different strengths of the different clubs and the different leaders.
So each year there's a conference, and that is run by the club that the governor is involved with. So you've just finished a whole weekend of the conference that was run by Wellington, but it was in the Wairarapa.
That's exactly right. And so I was actually very lucky then. I had support of a number of clubs.
Yes, you did. Yeah,
yeah, which was great. So my own club, the Rotary Club of Wellington, was a key supporter, and my small conference committee was chaired by one of my colleagues within Rotary Club of Wellington. So that was great. But then, because I wanted the conference in the Wairarapa, I, of course, needed the support of the Wairarapa clubs. Mm. And honestly, they were brilliant. Mm. They were so supportive and so helpful and so keen to do things to help. And so it was just lovely.
I think you sold the Wairarapa too, from what was going on. Couldn't you give us a rundown of what exactly was the weekend, you know, to go to a conference, what it's all about?
Yes, okay. So I hope I sold the Wairarapa. That was certainly it was my intention to do that. So with the conference, I had a dual theme to it. And one of the themes was a taste of the Wairarapa. Mm. So Kevin and I are foodies. We love the food and the wine that we're lucky enough to have access to here. And we wanted to spread that word. And so the taste of the Wairarapa was a part of it. And we certainly gave people an opportunity to do that. And then, so the way that we did that was on the Friday night, we had a very informal opening to the conference, and it was at Cobblestones Museum in Greytown, and it was a beautiful night, thankfully. And so we had a number of food providers, sort of food trucks, and they each sold their wares, and we identified a selection of wares. We had some Wairarapa wines. And we had Kurunui College Kapa Haka Group, which was great. So there were a number of local, things attached to that, and that went really, really well.
And you had the Rotary Club singing for...
Of course we did. How could I forget that?
How could you forget that?
So the Rotary Club of Marston South has its own choir.
Yes, that's right.
And they were great. Yeah. That was really lovely to be able to give you guys an opportunity to entertain us. Yes. It was lovely. So that was the taste of the Wairarapa on the Friday night. And then on the Saturday night, the taste of the Wairarapa was based around a wonderful do that we had.
And just coming into our studio at the moment is Freya. And Freya's going to be talking to us in a little while about Ryder. So welcome, Freya, and I'll turn you on in a moment when you've got yourself settled.
Thank you, Marilyn.
Nice to see you, Freya.
And
I'm just talking about the Saturday night of the conference.
The conference.
Wonderful photos on Facebook.
So yes, we had a lovely night on Saturday night, and that was, so the rest of the conference was at the Carterton Event Centre.
Yes.
And hence the Saturday night was there. So the as I said earlier, there were two themes to the conference. One was a taste of the Wairarapa, and the second was future-proofing our proud heritage. And the reason that I focused on that was that this year is a really important year for Rotary in New Zealand. It's our centennial year.
Oh, okay.
Yes. Yeah. So this effectively was our centennial conference.
Mm.
And so it's really important that we, we're very proud of everything we've achieved over the last 100 years, and we have achieved some really great things. But we need to future-proof ourselves, because we need to be able to tell a story, or others need to tell it for us, in another 100 years and beyond.
Yes.
And so I am very interested in what needs to be done in order to change, to future-proof, to set ourselves up in a way that we are going to be able to move forward into the future. And so that was one of the other that was the other theme. And so that fitted with the Saturday night, because I asked all of the clubs who attended the conference to dress up to represent the decade in which they were chartered. So we had a wonderfully colourful night, mm-hmm. and clubs were dressed up in so many different outfits and representing so many different decades, and it was great fun. It really was.
That's wonderful. Yeah.
And so the Saturday night really was a buzz. In terms of the food, we had Entice catering for us and provided beautiful food. So once again, a reflection of the Wairarapa,
yeah.
and once again the wines, reflecting the Wairarapa as well, and not just the wines. We had mallow fruit juice. We had a local beer from Carterton.
Oh yes,
so yes, and we were very grateful to a lot of those suppliers for helping us out there. And then, yeah, the Saturday night was great fun. We had this lovely food, and then we had Steve Carlin, who a crooner. I'm sure you all know Steve, the crooner from Greytown, and he was great, and everybody loved him. And he sang songs to reflect the different decades, actually.
Oh, lovely!
Which was really lovely.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then once Steve had finished, and we'd finished our meal. Andy Eldred, and his band Good as Gold got up, and Andy's a rock star, and so he was so good. He and his band were wonderful, and we say that Rotarians typically go home after the meal at conference. That didn't happen this time.
Oh, that's good. Oh, excellent. No, that's wonderful.
That was great,
yeah. Oh, so that's very, very successful. So talking about future-proofing, have you got ideas yourself about where it should go? Is it going to go ahead? Are we going to have Rotary clubs in the next 10, 20 years even?
We must do. We have to. But we do need to look at how we can do things differently. Rotary is thriving in some parts of the world, but it's actually declining in many of the Western countries. And that's a real concern. And so Australia and New Zealand, the UK, the US are declining in numbers.
I'll just bring Freya in on this one too. Do you think there's a reason for that? What do you think, Freya? Have you got any ideas on that?
I suppose the needs of each geographical area are different. What you're saying, Gillian, perhaps is that it's thriving in developing countries like India, China, Asia. Those areas where
I think Rotary is seen differently in some of those countries, and so it's in India in particular, and some of the other Asian countries, it's seen as something that people really want to belong to, and it's almost a professional status to become part of Rotary. And it's not that here. I think it used to be, actually.
Yes. So why do you think that happened? Anyone know?
Yeah.
Or is it just because we tend not to join clubs so much now?
It could be that. I think that we need to be really cognizant of the fact that we need younger people in Rotary. We don't only need young people. Our current Rotary International President, Holger Knack, says that any age is a good age to become a Rotarian, and that's a really important message.
Yes, I think so. Yeah.
So I certainly support that people of any age can add real value to Rotary. But we do need younger people, though, because if we don't bring younger people in, then you know, inevitably we are going to die out, and there won't be that energy coming through. And what's really important, I think, is that we recognise the fact that many younger people are not interested in meeting in the traditional Rotary way. And so traditionally Rotarians have met over a meal once a week, and we've had a guest speaker. And, you know, and that's been how Rotary works. And I enjoy that still, and you enjoy that still, I'm sure. But a lot of young people will say, yes, I'd love to help in the community. I'd love to do good. I'd love to make a difference. But I haven't got time to attend meetings. And often I can't afford to pay for
a regular meal. Yes,
so we've got to do things differently. And so Rotary International is giving that opportunity. They are really... they really understand that, that things need to change, and so we can now be a lot more flexible, and we are now encouraging people to perhaps meet away from a meal, you know, and only and rather than focusing on a meeting, maybe focus on joining or being part of a cause or a project, a community-based activity, you know. So
it's almost as though you could have your core Rotary group, but when there's a something happening in the town, you've got a group of people that you could call on to join just for that particular thing.
Or they could have made their set up their own Rotary club, but in a different way. And so there's a real push for satellite clubs to be set up. So a satellite club is attached to an established club, and they can meet in an entirely different way, and they can do things much more flexibly. And so they're Rotarians, but they are just not meeting in the traditional way. And often young people are attracted to that type of thing. So, you know, there are different ways that we can encourage young people to be involved in a way that works for them.
So what do you think about that, Fred? Do you reckon that... your younger members of the family would be keen to join, or
they're interested in knowing about Rotary, and they've got a fairly good knowledge of what Rotary does. But family life's changed drastically from when we joined, and when there was JCs, and people went from JCs to Rotary. There are Rotary clubs and all around, though, too, aren't there?
There are.
In the Wairarapa, but Massey University's got a Rotary club with a very diverse group of young people, very active. Carterton's got a satellite club.
So how's that going? Do you know anything about that?
I think it's going pretty well. Isn't it, Jillian?
I think it's going well. It needs support, but it's certainly it has got that good support there. Yes,
and it's been talked about. We need to do things in different ways for quite some time. And as sadly to say, as Rotarians get older, and there are clubs where there are young people, but where they get older, you need energy to develop new
That's
ideas.
Right. Yeah. Oh.
And perhaps the energies, the ideas are there, but perhaps the energy mightn't be quite there.
That's right, Freya. But I think that's where we do need to identify how younger people can join us, and therefore they can roll up their sleeves and they can get involved in the projects, which they love to do anyway. You know, it's what young people are often about. Yes.
I think we also need to do a lot more publicity about what Rotary is and what
don't
it does.
We?
Because it was always a bit of a secret, not a secret society, but, you know, people went off to their Rotary meetings and what were they doing. But then as we discovered with our club, how many things, I mean, one of the reasons we got voted the most beautiful city in New Zealand was of all the community projects that our Rotary had been involved in.
Yes.
And once you start to list them, and I don't think a lot of people really know what goes on, and I think that's the most important thing, is to get out and advertise what's happening.
Yeah. I totally agree, and we're not good at waving our flag, are we? We really are not, and that absolutely needs to change. You're right.
Yeah.
Go to any of these towns or cities that Rotary is part of, and there are so many things that Rotary has established or been involved in.
Yes. Yeah.
And but we don't tell people enough. So I'm really keen, as I've been going around the clubs this year, I've been really encouraging clubs to make it much more obvious what they're doing. And actually, one good way to bring in new members, I think, is to go to the community and find out what they need and how Rotary might be able to help them, and then ask that the community to help us to do it.
Yeah,
because, you know, once again, as you say, we're getting older and there are some great opportunities out there, but we can't necessarily do them ourselves. But if we engage the community in working with us, it's another way to engage the community in within Rotary.
Yeah.
And I think we've just got to do that more and more. We need to show the flag.
It's very positive. And so how long have you got as your district governorship?
Just till the end of June.
Oh, okay.
So another 3 months.
And then what is life for Gillian after that?
Goodness, ask my husband.
He'll be able to have you back again.
Actually, Kevin has been hugely involved as well. It is a role that it's... it does take a partnership.
Well,
it doesn't have to, but certainly if there is a partnership, it makes things a lot easier. Really, I don't know. I am really passionate about building membership and retaining members and supporting change in Rotary.
Yeah.
And so I hope that I'll have an opportunity district wide or even maybe beyond that.
To do something
around that, because that really is my passion.
It's excellent. Oh, well, I think you might need a break for a little while. We'll just have a bit of music before we get on to Freya. So
I've been swatting.
Oh, good. Right, so let's just put some music on. Well, there we had Any Dream Will Do, and I think that could be the dream for Rotary in the future from Joseph, of course. So welcome back to Rotary Matters, and we now have Freya Kerr to welcome you particularly, who is the District Coordinator of a program called rider. So perhaps you could tell us what rider is.
Right. Thank you, Marilyn. Rider, it's an acronym. It was Rotary Youth Driving Awareness. And it is now under the auspice of Road Safety Education Limited, which is an Australasian non-profit making organisation with the CEO based in Australia and our office, the New Zealand office in Auckland. But Rotary plays a very, very important role in RIDA because we are the community partner. And so the program is within New Zealand. We have coordinators who sort of roughly relate to our Rotary districts, I suppose. Mm-hmm. So we've got in the lower North Island, we've got Natalie Alabaster, who's based in the Hutt Valley and who is a superb organiser, manager of our RIDA programs. But yes. I'll just go back a bit to the history of what RIDA's about, because it was a Rotary initiative, and I'll find the right piece of paper. it came about in 2000. This is in Sydney. Four teenage boys were killed in a car driven by an inexperienced, or would a P-plate, which in New Zealand would be a provisional.
Yeah, provisional. Yes,
yes, registered. The car smashed into an innocent woman's vehicle, and the woman was seriously injured, and all four young men died. The local Rotary Club there decided that something had to be done, and the first RIDA program, which was Rotary Youth Driving Awareness, was conducted by the St Ives Rotary Club in 2001.
Oh, so it's 20 years ago.
Yeah, so this was the beginning of RIDA, and a community-based road safety initiative created to deliver practical road safety information, targeting attitude and awareness of young drivers and passengers. And so RIDA was designed to help stop the tragic loss of young people to road crashes. So since that time, it's grown like Topsy, hasn't it? It has, and within New Zealand, there would be about 50 clubs at least, or not clubs, 50 venues for RIDA. In our district, we would have about 20 clubs involved in RIDA each year. Unfortunately, last year, RIDA happened for some,
right,
and not
time.
For others, depending on when lockdown was. But Road Safety Education Limited had a great initiative, and they went online. And so for those clubs that, or those schools and clubs that could not participate in RIDA, they had online programs with lots and lots of interactive workshops for students, parents, teachers. So that was one way of sort of making sure that there was some
something going
continuity.
On. And so we've been involved in the Wairarapa over about
about seven years. I was the first person as when I was the assistant governor. We started that here. So, and a couple of years ago, we won the Australasian.
Oh, you could talk about that. You can.
for our involvement, and it wasn't just Rotary. There was the participating partners. For example, Wairarapa Road Safety Council, which is a huge, huge supporter of RIDA.
Bruce and Holly.
So, and the funders and other community people like WAGS, who supply the car for us each year, and all the Rotary clubs involved. And so there's South Wairarapa, and there's Carterton, Masterton Rotary, and Masterton South. And every year when RIDA comes up, they contribute in a range of ways. It can be, well, certainly providing volunteers, and the role of the volunteer at RIDA is to actually accompany, guide students around the workshops, and we'll talk about the workshops soon when you get around to it. Guide them around the workshops and just make sure that they go in a timely fashion. I can remember one year at Solway Showgrounds.
Was that the year it rained? No,
the sprinklers were on the
Yes, that's right. Yes, it's a year it rained, but the sprinklers, that's right.
It took a long time to get from one side of the oval to the other because we have to split
that's
between
right.
the two. And there were dancing students. And
they loved it.
They loved it.
But the volunteers were
there. We had to be very timely because each of the six workshops is half an hour. And
that's right.
We've got a transition time. So anyway, we won that award.
That was well deserved, and
was.
I think also for
a
lot of your work too.
Oh well, and others, and there was a lovely, lovely dinner at Solway.
That's right. Yes.
And the CEO came over from Australia and gave the awards out. Yeah. My husband got one. He was on Eastern Central Community Trust at the time, and they are one of our
major sponsors.
That's that was really good. So I'm rambling a bit.
No, that's fine. So we'll just go to what year level, and I know it changed a little bit this year because of the lack last year, but the normal year level is
year 12. Yeah. So with flexibility, and as you say, this year, because so many missed out last year, the Manawatū schools managed to get into the rider program just before the lockdown. And I think we had about 3 days' notice to say it's not happening. So year 12 and 13 from the participating colleges. So that is Kuranui, Chanel, Solway, Wairarapa,
Makaurau,
St. Matthew's Rathkill, and the teen parent unit is also
involved
a participator too. So they have students from there coming each year. So, and there's about 8 Rotarians involved in each day. We had 4 days this year.
This year, yes, because normally it's only 3, isn't
now,
it?
Yeah. And that involved approximately 700
students.
Year 12 and 13 students who had that wonderful opportunity to experience the rider program. So that was great, yeah.
So what do they do at Rider?
Okay.
Because I've sat through many of the...
Right, and it changes.
It did. So it changed
it
this
change.
Year, yes.
It's really responsive to...
Yes, to what they want and what...
To about changes. They work in with the New Zealand, what is it, road board, I would say it is, complies with the Waka Kotahi NZTA road safety guidelines
That's right.
for road safety programs. So, and it includes interactive workshops and classroom group sizes.
And it is all at not a cost to the student, but to the about $10 to the student for the school. Is that right?
Well, it depends on how the school wants to do that, if they've built in that cost in their annual planning.
Yes.
But it costs about $50 per student to run, so is an expensive program, and Road Safety Education Limited is highly reliant on getting funding this year. Funding came again for Eastern and Central Community Trust, and that has been very, very supportive right from the first rider workshop. And also COGS, which is the Community Organisation Grant Scheme in the Wairarapa, and Trust House Foundation. So in the past we've had funding from the Marsden District Council, South Wairarapa Council, Carterton, certainly Wairarapa Road Safety have given money. So each year there might be someone else that contributes. Now, Rotary clubs always contribute in some way, and not only is it the volunteer role, but they may give money or support in other ways. One club funds and provides all the lunches for the teachers, facilitators and volunteers that attend each day. And this year there were the 4 days, so a club paid for the main bulk of the meals, and the clubs provided little extras for morning tea and lunch. There's another club that provides, pays for the transport of the students for their bus transport to the venue and
yes,
back.
That's right.
So otherwise it's quite a long distance. So so there are other ways. Also, I must really mention too that we have got the rapid response team, who
Oh, you're so wonderful.
They were wonderful.
And I missed out this year.
All over New Zealand.
I was too late going to get my sausage.
You didn't get your sausage.
I didn't get my sausage, yes. No. And I went round to get my sausage and they just packed up everything. But they're wonderful.
They are, and they just turn up. And
do you know about them, Gillian?
No.
They're all over New Zealand. I think, I'm not speaking out of turn, I think they're a Brethren.
Yes, they are
tied into a religious group. And they've got their truck with all of the, and if there's a need, they're there, and they provide for us sausages and bread for the students and water, and they just come and set up. And
it's just wonderful. It really is. It's all free, nothing.
Yeah. Goodness gracious, I haven't heard of them.
So they're absolutely great. And you can access them on Facebook. They've got the Rapid Response. It's got a Facebook page, and you can see just the wonderful work they've done.
Yeah, no, they're really, really worthwhile.
Emergencies and just community things. So that's their community. Part of their community service.
Right. Yeah.
Young people.
Yeah, they could be part of Rotary.
They could. Well, I know one of the clubs 1 year gave them quite a good donation, but just as out of gratitude and recognition for what they did.
That's very special.
Yeah.
So, yes. So, now, next question.
So tell me what... some of the workshops are. I know that there are some special ones, and I know that some of them particularly like the stopping and starting one. It's called something else. The one where they are shown how fast
stopping distance
stopping distances
cars, and they bowl over the dummy at the end, the poor dummy. So there are six workshops within about a 5 hour period, and then we've got the lunch break and morning tea break. They all come together at the beginning of the day and everything's explained to them, and but before they actually come to rider, the schools get all of the required paperwork that looks at health and safety issues, liability, what the program's about, teacher responsibility, because the teachers are responsible for the students, not the Rotarians. We support and guide. So that's really important. So the first workshop, I will just get me a piece of paper. Oh, there it is, right in front of me. So there are six interactive rider workshops, and the first one is speed and stopping, and this is when the poor stuffed person with the long black wig has bowled over. The students experience the relationship between speed and stopping distance through practical observations. So all of the workshops have very highly skilled, trained facilitators in their area of expertise, sort of top of the range. So the cars start up and stop at 40k, 60k and 80k.
Mm-hmm.
And so you're looking at how long or the distance it takes for a car to stop without hitting the dummy. So at 80k, of course.
Yeah. I just read the lovely answer from one of them? The favourite session was speed and stopping. I'm a physics buff, and learning about how speed affects the braking time and stopping distance was really eye-opening and fascinating.
Yeah. Mm.
And I thought that was a lovely, lovely comment whoever it was.
Yes. Yep. When Rider first started in the Wairarapa, students actually backseat passengers.
They did. They were in the car.
But, that's all to do with the liability and insurance. And that was one of the reasons, too, why Rider went from Rotary to Road Safety Education. It was a move from Rotary International that it actually went under the auspice of Road Safety Education. Because no liability with what was set up in the programs, with the changes, evaluations and changes, and with health and safety issues. But there's paperwork that needs to be read and agreed to. It's a volunteer for Rider. But anyway, so that's the first one, speed and stopping. And Rider workshops are always held away from the public as such. So we have our one in the Wairarapa and Solway Showgrounds.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there is a community of people and motorhomes and that, but they're off to the side. So we've got a clear roadway and workshops. It's one of the limiting things for Rider.
It's finding somewhere,
You've got to be able to find somewhere.
We're very lucky.
We're very lucky, and it's not ideal because you're moving between areas.
But it was easier this year because we didn't have to, only once have to go over to the other buildings.
Right. We weren't meant to, but there were changes in the buildings. So, and the second one, students see, it's called the I in Drive. So the student is putting his or herself in that driving situation, and students see how their personality is an important aspect of the total road safety equation. Now, for all of these workshops, there's a booklet, and there's lots of guidance there, information, links, and a place for them to write relevant information to them. And that's a
this one's really interesting.
Looking at their personality and how they're going to react to certain situations, being aware of risks and that commentary that that you have when you're driving.
Yes, that was an interesting one, the one about the commentary. It's like when you go for a driving test, you know, you should be saying to yourself, well, there's someone coming up on my right and I'm coming to a corner now. And I think that went over quite well with the students that I saw.
Actually, this is sort of a little bit of by the way, but on 7 Sharp last night, they were talking about road rage.
Oh, yes.
I didn't see it all. But Barry, in one of her replies to a question, what would you do, she said, oh, I commentate. I have a commentary, so it wasn't quite like this. Get out of the way or something. But that commentary is so important.
Students be aware of what's happening
around them. I can see a child on a bike going down the footpath, or someone's coming up behind me. The third workshop is road choices, and this is a discussion routinely led by a police officer on key risk areas for young drivers and passengers, and that's really informative about the differing licenses, the learners.
Yes. The one group that I sort of sat in on, there was I think they were over time because there were so many questions about, particularly about, you know, the fines and how many demerit points and all that sort of thing, and they really wanted to know.
There's still some little ambiguities in it, like questions such as, if I'm on a provisional license, can I take my sibling to school? And I've heard yes from someone who's an authority, and I've heard, well, maybe. And so there's still some little grey areas. And we've always had Marston police and other police coming from different areas to actually observe in our program have always led that. So we've got a group of facilitators that have been with us for quite a while, and we're really familiar with the program, and some that are new. So the next one is crash investigators, and Juliet is our person who has been the facilitator for this, and she had a horrific road accident. It's not an accident, a road
crash.
There was a crash, her partner at the time was driving the car, and he was speeding, and she ended up with horrific injuries, and 10 years later or so, she's still coming to terms with it, and she's been involved in RIDA for a long time, and it's really good for students and parents and the teachers to actually be aware.
We also had one year a guy who had a motorbike accident.
He came for quite a few years. He told his life story too. So that's really good. Then Mind Matters is fun.
That was
the one in the kitchen.
Yes,
they really get into it. It's full of drawing from a true story and role plays. Students look at the role of mood as a risk factor and develop strategies to recognise and change harmful mindsets, and they really get into it as they're being distracted. Someone's the driver and someone's trying to distract them, and the other people are watching and counting how many times that driver would be distracted with these ploys by the passenger, taking their eyes off the road that, and it gets quite excited.
that was a really good one, I thought. And they loved it.
What would you do? The things that are important, what distracts you, and looking at the discussion on music, the impact of music, does it Is it helpful or is it not?
Yes, that was an interesting question.
And the next one, the last one, is drive SOS. Students look at the road from the perspective of other road users, gaining an understanding of their challenges and learning how to drive so others survive. That's the key message. Drive so others. So good, so important. Those are the six workshops.
Yeah, no, that's excellent. And actually, I saw there was a note there, was it from Bruce, saying that they were hoping to make it a mandatory part of the curriculum, but which could be interesting.
It would be.
I don't know that it would. I don't know whether there's enough time in the curriculum to put it in.
Well, schools are including some aspects of road safety.
Yes, I think Kurunui does.
Does. I'm not sure what other schools do within their curriculum, and they can get credits. But RIDE is the leading and only national road safety program for youth in New Zealand. So providing young people with the skills and strategies that they need to stay safe on the roads. So, and it is formulated by a very, very highly skilled and knowledgeable international panel of people put it together. And after every, there are three lots of evaluation with the program, pre-program, on the day, and afterwards. So all of the evaluation has goes back, is analysed and put together, used, considered for updating the program. And within the last 2 years, I know there's been significant changes. We've got rid of Genevieve's story.
Yes.
Which was...
What happened there? It was outdated.
Yeah. New stuff came in, so they're regularly updating it. It was an Australian program, which is, you know, it's okay. But if you look at New Zealand and the roads, a lot of our students are used to rural roads.
And there was a very telling video about the lady with the child in the back seat.
Yes.
They're all very good programs.
Yeah, so it would be really good. And because it is approved by the traffic people, you know, it is. It's recognised as an award-winning
program. Definitely, yeah.
Yeah, but certainly big changes have been made. That Mind Matters is a fairly new one.
Yes, that's new. That was
comment that has come in over the years is that perhaps in the afternoon some of the students start falling asleep. Well, the more interactive... we can get it. The more
I think that's
like
important.
Learning experience. It's the doing.
That's right. Well, Gillian, you were an ex-teacher. You know that. I know what it's like.
It is the doing, and certainly that Mind Matters. And they like the speed stopping too. But
we got to thank you for all the work that you do. I mean, Freya's. You know, she's wonderful. She just sort of. Gets volunteers, but you do just a wonderful job and do all the organisation, and it's really wonderful.
Well, I had Rod O'Leary help me this year.
Good.
He's a good guy.
No, he was great. He's a good guy.
He's a good guy.
I had a few little things that needed sorting out.
He and I were parking vehicles at the wings over Wairarapa, and that was quite fun with him. And then he was there on Saturday, and I think we were doing dishes or something like that, and it's a bit different from the parking of the car.
But going back to those evaluations and inclusion of RIDE in the school curriculum, in recent research or evaluation of feedback, 96% of the 873 classroom teachers who were surveyed, that's Australasian. 96% thought it should be a compulsory subject in the senior school curriculum.
Thank you very much. We need to be starting to wind up now with the program, but thank you both for all the information you've given us, and it's lovely to have you with us, Gillian, and all the best for the rest of your tenure.
Thank you.
And
thank
hopefully
you,
we can see you around the Wairarapa, you know.
Absolutely. Yes, absolutely. Thank you. I've really enjoyed being here. It's been lovely.
Good.
Thank you.
And Freya, thank you for all the work you do.
Oh, that's right. Thank you. I feel a bit sort of haven't done as much as I should have, but no. That's good. It's very, very, I mean, one of the reasons I got very involved in this is through personal family situations, and especially within the Wairarapa, there have been some dreadful tragedies with young people.
Yeah.
And that awareness.
We can do something about it.
I mean, it's not a driving course.
No, but it's an awareness.
That awareness is just so...
So important.
So important, yes. Yeah.
Right, well, thank you very much. And you've been listening to Rotary Matters on 92.7 FM. And, of course, you've been watching us on... Wairarapa TV. Now, this program normally is on the first Friday of the month and then repeated on Saturday, but we're just a little bit before that because at the end of next week it will be Easter. So thank you very much to both of my guests today, and all the best, and as I said, I hope we see you around more, Julian, you. When you have a bit more time.
And membership, yeah.
And also, and Freya, of course, we'll be seeing you at Rotary. So I'm Marilyn Buzaid, and wishing you all a very good weekend, because it's going to be lovely and fine, and also a lovely Easter.
Thank you, Marilyn.
Thank you, Marilyn.
You do a superb job. For years you've been doing...
Oh, yes, I just like talking.
Yeah, no, but you have. It's quite a commitment, yeah.